I know, unfortunately, a lot of Catholics don't believe in purgatory. And we have a lot of influence from Protestants, people that listen to all these TV evangelists and are so contaminated with these amazing beliefs that Jesus saved us already, His blood covered us, and He paid for us. So we're not to suffer, and we are not to go to purgatory. So that is not true. One of the reasons I am talking about purgatory today is because I am testifying to something that I didn't read in a book. It's nothing that I was taught by anybody. This is something that I've been through myself. The Lord, in His amazing, mysterious way of doing His pedagogy with us, the souls, He took me through this, and He put me through this, and I can testify to what I have been through. I have seen, and I have lived purgatory, and I testify to that with my life. With my life, I do, because I don't want any of you to go to purgatory. I don't want any of you to go to hell. No one. And God doesn't want any single soul to be wasted. That's why I'm here, testifying to this with my life. Because this is nothing I read. It's something I've been through. And I can tell you this. The church and the fathers of the church, the mystics of the church, have amazing amount of information given to us about purgatory. Hundreds of pages. But it's so sad that a lot of Catholics today, they have any single book about Bill Graham, Benny Hill, all kind of preachers all over the world, but they have no books on the mystics of the church. And it's very sad. And you know why? Because of that little tube that is in the living room. You know, because of TV. So I'm talking about going back into the very heart of the church. And I'm not putting down any other church or putting down any other believer in Christ. Don't take me wrong. I am talking about being a Catholic. We have to be what we are called to be. One of the things the Lord taught me about my faith is you have to be and live up to what you were given. So we have to be a real Catholic. How can you be a real Catholic? Study your faith. Learn the catechism. Study the mystics of the church before you go and talk to your neighbor. Because you know what happened? When you go out and dwell, listening to all these teachers of Christ outside the Catholic Church, they're going to get you to the wrong places. You know why? Because you don't know your faith. And that's why so many people are taken away from the church. Because they are so impressed with these amazing preachers that can quote you the Bible by the seconds. You know, they tell you two words and they say John 17:4 and this and the other every second. And people are really impressed with that. But I tell you something, when you hear the three temptations of Christ, you hear the devil quoting the scriptures to Jesus. He knows them by heart too. So don't be impressed by people knowing so much about God, by people preaching so well and being so articulate. I tell you something, I never studied theology. I didn't even know the catechism. I don't take a single note before I give a talk of in any subject. The Lord gave me this. So we don't need to go and be so sophisticated about learning anything. We have to love the Lord and let Him do it. And I'm not saying that it's wrong to study. I'm not saying that it's wrong to be a theologian and to go through the studies of the church. It's not that. But I'm saying it's not about being impressed with learning and with the great wisdom we achieve by studying. It's by being impressed of how much have you given yourself to the Lord. Because the Holy Spirit is the one that's going to come and do it and do the job. And you never have to worry about what you're going to say. That is a promise of the Lord. And it's something that I'm a witness to. Because I stand here, I didn't think for a second what I was going to tell you. I knew I was called to speak about purgatory. I'm going to do the best I can to be an instrument of the Lord to speak to you about purgatory. Because I don't know anything about it. He knows it all. Right? So we hope the Holy Spirit is the one doing the job. And I can show you this. In my mystical experience, I was placed... If you were here when I testified on my testimony two nights ago, and you probably heard some of the accounts that I related to you as to where I was in that vision, related to my trial with the Lord. Then for those that weren't here, I can tell you that I went through this mystical experience with the Lord. First, the illumination of conscience, while I was awake and conscious, and then I went into a vision where I was put to a trial. And in this trial, I was on a lake with the water up to my waist. And in front of the lake, there was a rock, a golden rock, where I have seen the Lord. And then I was put to a trial. This is what happened. While I was in the lake, I have seen the army of the devil. I seen it. Millions, millions and millions and millions, that you can never count them, ever, of devils, you know, demons, whatever you can call them, spirits of the dark. And then millions of souls that were wasted, condemned souls, millions. I tell you what I saw. When we are here, during this life on earth, in the flesh, we are going in two directions. One, we are becoming a saint. We are looking for sanctity. We are sanctifying ourselves, or we are demonizing ourselves. It's the only two directions we are taking. So when you get closer and closer to God, you sanctifying yourself. Then when you leave the body, you are a saint. You are like an angel. Like the Lord very clearly says it in the scriptures. When he was being tested by the Pharisees, they were asking him, whose husband is this woman going to be? She married seven brothers. And then the Lord says, nobody, because you're going to be like angels in the afterlife. So we will be like angels. But then, you know what? If you go the wrong direction, you will be like angel, like a fallen angel. You'll be like a demon. So what I saw in the lake, I was in the territory of Satan, because I was in mortal sin, not repented. Because even though I was there in the presence of the Lord, all I wanted to do was run away from mercy, run away from forgiveness. That is the result of mortal sin. It builds you up in pride and self-love, and you are not able to receive love, mercy, forgiveness, compassion from anybody, much less from God. That is the fountain of all. So now, I am there, trying to run away from grace, and I'm surrounded by the devil. I am in the devil's territory. That's where I am. And I tell you, there is no more scary sight ever you can ever dream to see than that. And even though I saw the devils, I saw all that army as human beings. They looked like human beings, but I knew they weren't human beings. They were fallen angels and condemned souls that turned into demons. But I saw them as human beings because each one of them represented my sins. You see, so I have seen at once all my sins of impurity. They look like all the women I fornicated with, like all the women I committed adultery with. And I knew those weren't the women, but they looked like them. And you know, I remember every one of those sins, because since they were not forgiven, because I left the church for 33 years, left the sacrament of confession, of penance, all the sins were present. You notice when Jesus told Peter that he was giving the key to heaven to him, that everything he will lose on earth will be losing heaven. And that power that he gave the apostles to forgive sins or to retain them is a fact. You see, I was not absolved. Therefore, I was tied to the devil in the presence of the Lord, because I was not absolved. All of my sins were present in the presence of God. And this is the most painful thing. And on top of that, I didn't want forgiveness. I wanted to run away. I hated myself. I hated the devil. And I knew I was going to end up hating God. So now, where I am, this is what happened. I'm there, and I noticed every single sin was guarded by a fallen angel. You see, in the beginning of our sinful life, we are being tempted by the lower army of Satan. And you know who the lower army of Satan is? Condemned souls. The ones that demonize themselves. It's like on the opposite direction, where we intercede. When we look for intercession, we go to the saints, right? It's like the lower army of the Lord. Not because they are less than anybody else in heaven. It's just an army, and it's a hierarchy. And there are different choirs of angels, and there is a hierarchy in heaven. So is in hell. There is a hierarchy. So when you begin to walk a sinful life, in the beginning you get these demons that are condemned souls, that begin to back you up on your little sins. And then, the more you continue on the territory of the devil, the hierarchy that is coming along to back you up. So, a life like mine, a sinful life of 33 years, I had principalities of the devil backing me up. Principalities. I had princes of the dark, fallen angels of a great stature, that were the ones that were already using me as an instrument of impurity, as a liar, as anything, and I was a professional already. It's like my father was giving us his testimony yesterday. He was saying he people will believe him. He looks so cute and he was doing this. That's what it is, the devil working through us. You know, he gets us to do the most amazing things, because then all these principalities come along, dominions, all of these choirs of fallen angels. And then I saw all of this, and they were guarding. You see, every single sin that you commit has a backer, and sometimes a legion backing it up. And you turn into the most amazing professional sinner. And you can do things perfectly. That's why you wonder, why is it that people that are so evil are so successful? How come nothing happens to them? And the good people, always bad things are happening to them. I tell you why, because they are backed up by an army. And they have the invisible army, the spirits in the air, backing them up. But you know what they're going to get out of that? They're going to get hell out of that. That's why they are successful. What good does it do if we win this life, like the gospel says? If we're going to lose our eternal life, what good does it do to have all this power and all these amazing gifts of this earth if we're going to lose our life? Because I have seen the condemned souls. I have seen hell. And I tell you something, this is something beyond anybody's imagination. This is not a game. Our life is serious. It's very serious. We have to be awake. We have to be concerned about everything we're doing. Every little thing we're doing. About every little thing we're thinking. About everything we're saying. About everything we're touching. About everything we're feeling and desiring and wanting. All of those things, you have to think about it. And you have to place them at the foot of the cross and ask the Lord for mercy and compassion, because we are not able to do it on our own. We are helpless about it or without the Lord. That's why this great army of Satan comes along with all this power. But you know something? Even the smallest soldier of Christ is going to be able to defeat the greatest army of the devil. The smallest soldier. Only for now. Praise the Lord, because we have the power, and the power is Jesus. He gave it to us, and He's here with us. He's fighting with us, and He gave us all of the weapons, all of them. You know, we have the greatest weapons in our Catholic Church. I was shown my faith, even though I was the last Catholic, gone. And the Lord showed me the power that we have in the rosary, the stations of the cross. You want to torture the devil? You want to really torture the devil? Go yes. For the stations of the cross. Because he will run away. Run away. You know? Yes. He will run away. There was not a single demon can be around the stations of the cross. And pray them really loud. Really loud. Yes. Because you see them running. You see them running. You see, we have weapons that are unbelievable. Weapons that we won't believe how powerful they are. We can change demons from a whole city if we really scream the stations of the cross while we walk through a mall, while we walk through a hospital, while we walk through the streets. Just pray them. Pray them. And you will chase them away from people that are in chains with the devil. You can do it because we have the power in us. You see, but then I am there in the waters of hell. And at the same time, because of Our Lady. When I saw Our Lady, and I told you yesterday that I have seen Our Lady the day before, I have seen Our Lady. And Our Lady is the queen of the souls in purgatory. You know, the biggest relief ever, you imagine. She's always interceding for them. She feels for them. You see, purgatory is a state of the soul. This is the way I saw it. When we leave this body, we have only two ways to go. One, we will fly into God. And other, we will sink into the bowels of the earth. There is no other way. You see, the soul is like a dove. But you've never seen a dove with a backpack or a suitcase, right? The dove that is loaded cannot fly. You see, so what happened to a soul that is loaded with earthly life? Attached to everything, is not able to take off. So what happens when you leave the body? You go down, because you don't have flesh anymore to stay in this illusorial material world, because it is an illusion when you look at it from the spiritual world. It's just an illusion. But to us, it's everything. You see, now, when you leave, when this body dies, and your soul is there, there's no place to go, because you can't be here. You can't go to God, because you're loaded of attachments to the earth. Where do you go? Below here. Below. And that is a very scary state. You see what I saw? When I was standing on that lake at the same time, all of a sudden I felt, when I saw the presence of Our Lady, I felt an amazing large valley of loneliness. You know, cold as ice. Cold. And it was packed with millions of souls. You see? And then at the same time, there was a great valley of fire that was, it looked like hell, but it was not hell, it was purgatory. You see, it was purgatory. It was souls that made it, but didn't make it to sainthood. And they had to purgate, they had to be purified. But I tell you this, purgatory is a state of sainthood, because souls in purgatory can no longer sin. They don't have flesh. And then also, they accepted the Lord as the Lord and rebuked the devil forever. So they are holy as you can get. They have not even the smallest doubt of guilt, no longer. It's about charity already, and it's about love. But they suffer in the loose, because they are separated from God. They cannot be with Him. And that's the most painful thing to go through. And also, the pain of the senses, you know, because the fire or the cold is either too cold or is either fire. And I tell you, on this life, this earthly life, in the flesh, if you put your finger in a little candle flame, you can stand burning. Imagine if you get the fire of the divine punishment on you, that is a fire beyond your imagination. It burns. And it burns beyond anything you can ever dream. So, therefore, souls in purgatory are either between, are always between that cold and that heat of the flames of purgatory, the purifying flames. And this is very difficult to explain in human words, because there's no way you can ever translate the spiritual realm into a human realm. But the best I can do is to tell you this. Levels of purification in purgatory are so large. There are so many levels that if we all die here at this very moment, as I told you before, we probably not going to be able to see each other, because we all going to be in a different level, according to what we have done with our lives regarding and related to God and to the devil. So it depends on where we were. So here is what happened. If the devil is guarding vice and sin, and the angels of the Lord are guarding virtues, at the moment of death, the account, the economy of the soul comes up immediately. And you are the result of what you did in relationship with sin and grace. So what is purgatory? Purgatory is the final result of your deeds. Now, when you end up with an account in red, because you are not at peace with God, and you didn't attain sainthood on earth, then you are facing a purification. Purification is filled with hope, because you know, and you are told by the angels of the Lord. You see, when I was in a state of suffering, in the presence of Our Lady, and I felt like I was in this amazing valley of suffering, I had the angels of the Lord, my guardian angel, the angels of the Lord, letting me know the hope of salvation is present in the mercy and forgiveness of God. But I was not accepting it. But I know a soul in purgatory, like the ones I saw, the millions I saw, they were all already in the presence of mercy. So they accepted it. They were different than me. They accepted it. And they had that hope in them. They had that beautiful hope that they knew they were saved. But they knew they couldn't present themselves to the eternal banquet of the Lord, because they were not properly dressed. They were filled with all kinds of sins that were not purgated, that were not repaired during the earthly life. So they were purgated. They were purifying themselves. So the most beautiful prayer you can ever see is the communion of saints. I never knew what that meant, but I've been through that myself. I was in it. And this is how it works. If you are here praying for a soul in purgatory, what you do is this. We are the militant church on earth, as you know. And they are the purgating church, the suffering church, and then we have the triumphant church in heaven. So what happened? How do we get together to be the communion of saints? You are here kneeling, praying for a soul in purgatory. And then that soul in purgatory is lined up with you. Both of you are looking up to heaven for mercy and compassion to the triumphant church. That is the perfect communion of saints. What does it do? What it does is you are in the flesh. The soul you're praying for has no flesh left to repair. It's purgating what was not able to repair. So whatever the soul is suffering at that moment, let's say the soul in purgatory is suffering the sin of being so cruel to the father, to the mother, to the sister, some irreverence in the church, whatever sin that soul is purgating, is not able to move anywhere, is suffering for that. Then what happened at that moment? Through you, because you are sitting in your flesh, and you are able to present a reparation act on your own for that soul that could not repair on time and is purgating. United, you together will move a little closer into the light of the triumphant church, both of you. That's when people say, those souls in purgatory can pray for you? Because I tell you how it works. If you pray for them, you and them get closer to God. So that is the way the prayer is answered. Because both of you, in a communion with God, will get closer into the light and graces will fall upon you. So that's why being in tune with the churches, in the Trinitarian churches, is the best thing you can ever do. When you go to Mass, remember, the three churches are meeting right there. It's the biggest act of mercy ever given to us, the Eucharist. There's nothing that compares. You walk into a Mass, the Lord showed me the mystical presence of God in the church during the Mass. And this is so large that if we only see one little bit of this mystery, you will walk into the church on your knees. On your knees. Every single pew in the church is guarded by an angel. Every single pew. Every single fountain of the holy water is guarded by angels. Every column, every statue of a saint, not telling the altar, everything, the church outside, the walls outside, everything is guarded against the enemy. And still, you see the enemy walking into the church. And you know how he walks into the church? You've probably seen a prisoner in chains being escorted by a guard in a plane, in a train, or in the street. Have you seen sometimes somebody in handcuffs being escorted by a guard? And they are together. That's the way Satan walks in into the church, with a prisoner. That's the only way he can walk in there, with a prisoner. And he walks in there. Now, the lukewarms are in a lot of trouble in the church, because they are the prey of the devil, so easy. You know, a lukewarm is going to be distracted with somebody's dress. You know, it's going to be distracted with somebody's cough. It's going to be distracted with somebody's way of walking. And anything is going to be a distraction, because that person is not in tune with God. He's not there visiting the Lord. He's visiting his little mischievous ways. That's what it is. So now, purgatory is all related directly to every single action on the flesh. We are here now, you see, and everything we do is into account. The same way every single hair of ours is counted. Our days are counted. Also our deeds are counted, each one of them. So now, we have the sacrament of confession, the penance, that we are going to solve by the absolution we are giving in the church, which is the greatest gift given to us before the greatest of all, that is the Eucharist. But we have to realize when we are going to confession, like I told you yesterday, we know we are getting ready of the army of the devil. Imagine what that means. If you could only see one little thing of what I saw, you would understand what I mean. It's the most amazing gift, to be unchained from the devil. If you die right after confession, you will find yourself in the presence of the Lord, free from the presence of the devil. That doesn't mean you are going to go straight to heaven if you haven't repaired the sins you were forgiven. Like the Council of Trent was saying, what I read in the beginning. You know, it's not that we confess our sins and that's it. You know, we are just forgiven and that's it. It's not about that. We have to repair We have to repair. Reparation begins with a real change of life. We have to really change. You can't keep on going to confession and keep on doing the same things all over again. You see, you cannot do that. I mean, we say, oh, I'm just a human. Oh, I tell you something. What Jesus came to teach us is to be able to die to that human being that you're talking about. We have to die to ourselves. So stop calling yourself, I am just a human. What can I do? You notice when you confess with a priest that is in real bad shape? Then you confess to him, Father, I'm sorry, I'm living in common law. I say, well, but you love her? I say, yes. I say, well, God understands. You know, that priest is in a lot of trouble, right? You know, he is in a lot of trouble. So you have to go and tell him, would you please absolve me from living in common law? You know, it's like you can't follow the one that is living in the dark, regardless of who he is. So we have to understand, we have to be real. We know what is true and what is not true. We have to realize that God has given us a law. And we have to learn our doctrine of the church. Because today, we're living in a world and in a church that is in a lot of trouble. It's very weak and depleted. And we have to understand who is who. And in order to understand who is who, we have to know the law. We have to know the commandments. You see, people think they never kill. And I tell you, the Lord showed me the commandments. And one by one, He showed them to me. And He showed me that I lived in the killing fields. I never thought I'd kill anybody. But I kill children's smile. I kill people's hope. I kill people's spaces. I kill and kill people's opportunities of salvation. I kill my own soul's opportunity of salvation. I kill and kill left and right. And people think they never steal. Well, we do a lot of that. That's why we can never take for granted that we are so good, like I was telling you yesterday. Because purgatory is going to show things you never imagined. So the reason I'm speaking about purgatory, even though I'm not a theologian and I cannot give you a specific theological ways of explaining it, I can only tell you my mystical experience. This is what I went through. I see angels of the Lord consoling the souls in purgatory, letting them know that they're going to heaven eventually. Some of them are going to be there until the end, until the judgment. And some of them are going to be released before time because of our intercessions. And now, because of divine mercy, the revelation to Saint Faustine, now that mercy is creating the most amazing blessings for souls in purgatory. Because it's bringing, you know, the prayer of Fatima, when we say, forgive our sins, save us from the fires of hell. All of these things are bringing all these blessings to the souls, you know, and releasing them earlier. You know what happens when souls are released from purgatory earlier? All of us get closer to God because we are a single mystical body. We are all together. You see, the more we triumph, the more souls that enter heaven, the more light we gain as a body, as a mystical body. We are all related. One to the other. So it's very important that I walk faithfully with the Lord. Because if I do, I bring light for everybody. And that's what that's about you too. Each one of you. We have to understand this. Even though purgatory is a horrifying place, it's a place of hope still. Because there's salvation in purgatory. So here's what happens. I was telling you about the dove that cannot fly because it's loaded. You have to learn how to let go of everything. Let go. Let go and meaning, this is the way I was explained by the Lord, how to let go. Learn about faith. Learn about Abraham, the father of faith. Who is Abraham? You see, for a lot of people, Abraham is an old man in the Bible. And remains in the Bible. They tell you who's Abraham. They pick the Bible to look where he is. And they tell you who he is. Abraham has to be here. We have to conceive Abraham in our heart. Who is Abraham? Let's put it this way. Isaac. Take everything you are attached to in this life. Your loved ones. Your possessions. Your want and desire. Because the worst possession we have in this life is want and desire. There is nothing worse than the things you haven't been able to get. You see, because you are frustrated. There are so many people in this world that are a mess because they haven't been able to get what they want. So they are angry and they are frustrated. And when you talk to them, you say, I haven't been able to move from this little house. It's like, we need a bigger house. We need a better car. We need a better job. We need this. We need that. I need to be loved more by my wife, by my husband, by my children. People don't understand me. This, all of these great wants and desires is a great possession. Take all of that. Wrap it up in a bundle. Wrap up your material possessions. Wrap up your loved ones. Wrap up yourself, your little self that you love so much. Wrap it up in a bundle and baptize it Isaac. And then bring it to the Lord and say, here I am, Lord. I am shaking. I'm trembling. I don't know what you're going to do with my Isaac. But here I am to sacrifice it. And I am shaking. You see, it's the only time that you can say you finally begin to understand faith. You see, the scripture says, if you only have faith as big as a mustard seed, you will be able to move mountains. And you notice we cannot even move a pencil. You see? So there's something wrong with our faith. The only way to get into the real faith is to learn Abraham. So meet Abraham in your bones. Bring it in. Bring him in. It's painful. It's not easy to bring Isaac to the altar to be sacrificed. To bring everybody. Remember Jesus? Your mother and brothers are out there. They say, no, my mother and brothers are those that follow the Father, that believe in him. You see, that is letting go. Letting go. It's like, I'm not talking about abandoning everybody and just going on your own with a backpack and leaving your mother and sister and children. No, it's about being with them, loving them, but not possessing them and not being attached to them. So what it is, not until you do that, you're going to understand what is the soul free of attachment that is going to be able to leave the flesh and fly to the Lord. Because if you don't do that, if you don't begin to let go now, you're going to be in a place that I'm talking about, purgatory. Because I'm sure you're far from going to hell. I'm sure about that. You wouldn't be here. You wouldn't be here. Believe me. People that come to a place like this to listen to things like this are about not to go to hell. But it's about very easy to go to purgatory because we are pretty loose about the way we go about our faith. So now the Lord is tightening up all the things that are loose in us. And that's why we're all here today. Because the Lord is tightening up everything. Getting us ready. Because some of you might be called tonight, tomorrow, in a week. We don't know. But we are all on call, for sure. So now. And you know how great it is to realize that we are on call? That is a great thing. Because a lot of people are very deaf. Oh, nobody ever called me. You see, oh really? Watch out, you know? See, like, then what happens here is we have to learn now how to release purgatory from our lives. We have to learn that. The Lord asks us to go to heaven, not to hell or purgatory. He's asking us to go to heaven. That's the calling. He didn't come here to say, by the way, I came here to teach you how to end up in purgatory. Never. That's not in the gospel. You see, he came here to tell us, I want you to go with me to where I am. I'm going before you to prepare a place for you. In heaven, not in purgatory, not in hell. So that's why we have to learn how to do it. How do we do it? Let go of everything. Let go. You see, I tell people that are so deep in the faith, like I was saying yesterday, they learn everything about the mystics. They follow in the most amazing spiritualities. And they know everything about it. But I tell them, why don't you give me a little test? Go home, open your closets, and look at it, and see how much of what you have there you're using, and try to give everything away that you don't use. Just try, and you're going to find out how much you have grown spiritually. You see? It's about that. We cannot fool ourselves. You know, we can't fool ourselves. We can spend our whole life in penances and praying the most amazing difficult prayers and doing the most amazing difficult pilgrimages and all of that. But if we haven't changed our little ways, it's nothing that we're doing. Nothing. We're building up a purgatory. Because you're going to be sitting by your closet for 2 centuries, right? So, let go. Let go of your shirts, and let go of your shoes, and all of these things. And you know something very funny? A lot of Catholic people that are very committed, they have 200 rosaries, and a lot of medals, and I don't know how many novenas, and all kinds of books. And I say, do you know how much you will benefit if you give a rosary away? The person that receives it never forgets you and is going to pray for you every time they hold that rosary. What are those rosaries doing in your closet? You know, you see, I mission in Latin America. And I go there to mission in very poor places, in the jungles of the Amazons, in Peru, Colombia, Venezuela, Ecuador. People that can never afford to buy a rosary. Not even. They cannot have a medal. They cannot have a novena. You know, they can't buy. They cannot afford it. And then I said to people, why don't you give away all of those things so they can be given to the poor? Be given to the poor, to people that don't know, don't have it. I seen people that have to make rosaries out of thread, you know, like things that they pick just to make them themselves because they can't buy it. So a lot of things we're doing wrong, you know, we holding into a lot. And those things are not good for you. Not good. Because if you check yourself out, all of those things are holding you into the world and away from God. And it's very subtle because the devil creeps in our religious life. The devil creeps in our spirituality. You see how people are possessive. Sometimes they have these little prayer groups and only one can speak. The rest have to shut up, you know. Yes. A lot of little holy ways, you know what I mean? Like, really holy ways. And all of those things are terrible because all of those things are getting people angry and building up a lot of stress. And sometimes I go to preach in little prayer groups and there's so much tension there. I think I walk into some kind of martial arts group or something, you know? Like they're ready to jump on each other. And it's all because we don't let go. We don't let go. We try to grab everything, control everything, or expect everybody to admire us and accept us. So we either controlling everybody or trying to expect everybody to approve us. So those two things are horrible because we have to stay out of the two. We have to stay with the Lord. We don't want anybody to approve us and we don't want to control anybody. We want to be with God, the one that really does it. So now, purgatory is all about that. Purgatory is built right here. So you want to let go of purgatory? You want to save yourself from purgatory? Begin to let go of everything. So know Abraham in your life. And he is going to save you from purgatory. It's the only way. Learn to let go. Because the only way you can really assure yourself that you're doing a real spiritual growth is if you learn how much you let go of everything. You see, like I was saying yesterday, you see monks and hermits and priests that left everything behind, but they didn't leave themselves. They are attached to themselves. You see priests that are so built up on themselves, they look like they are standing on a throne, you know? There's fire, yes. You see, they speak like this. They didn't let go of themselves. You know, they are a temple of pride. It is no more horrible. There is nothing more horrible than a bishop that is so much in pride, or a priest. Isn't that horrible? It's terrible. There's nothing more beautiful than a humble priest. Isn't that? It's like the greatest gift. Same thing happens with all of us, not only priests and nuns, but we have to let go. We have to stop being so important. We are nothing. You see, some people are a doctor all day long, 24 hours a day, a doctor, right? The attorney, oh, the rich one of the neighborhood, they are that all the time. You see, you have to stop being, we are nothing. We have to crumble, we have to demolish ourselves and become nothing because we are just dust and we're going to be buried. You see, the only thing that's going to be left of us is the love that we give, not the love that we receive, the love that we give. That's all that's going to be left of us. It's the only money that is going to be deposited in heaven. Love.
when a very great multitude was gathering together, and men from every town were resorting to him, he said in a parable, "The sower went out to sow his seed. As he sowed, some seed fell by the wayside and was trampled underfoot. And the fowls of the air came and devoured it. Other seed fell upon rocky ground, and as soon as it sprung up, it withered away because it had no moisture. Another seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up with it and choked the plants. Still other seed fell upon good ground and grew up and yielded a crop 100 times more than was sown. As he said these things, he called out, "He that has ears to hear, let him hear." But his disciples then began to ask him what this parable meant. He said to them, "To you it is given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God, but to the rest in parables, that seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand." Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. Those along the wayside are those who have heard, but then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, so that they may not believe and be saved. Now those upon rocky ground are they who receive the word with joy when they hear it, but these have no firm root. They believe for a while, but in time of temptation, they fall away. And the seed that fell among thorns, these are they who hear the word, but as they go on their way, they are choked by the anxieties and riches and pleasures of this life, and their fruit does not ripen. But the seed that fell upon good ground, these are they who have heard the word in an honest and good heart, and hold it fast, and bear fruit with perseverance.